続きまして、情報映像情報メディア学会の次期会長でございます土井美和子さんが、ユーザーオリエンテッドイノベーション取り組まれソサエティと題しましてのご講演をしていただきます。よろしくどうぞ。
ちょっと、割り込ませていただきます。私はこの IEEE の国際会学会の、責任者しております長谷と申します。ちょっと今から、先ほど、韓国電子情報通信学会のムン会長からお話しいただきました。ちょっと私、段取りが悪くて非常に申し訳ありませんでした。ムン会長は現在韓国電子情報通信学会の会長を、やっておられまして、で、ご経歴もちょっと私の方から説明、し忘れましたので、ちょっとここで割り込ませていただきます。ムン会長は韓国ソウル、国立ソウル大学を、80年に卒業され、韓国の先端科学技術大学で修士、カリフォルニア大学のアマイコで、ドクターを取っていらっしゃいます。で現在は、韓国の、ハンヤンユニバーシティの教授をされております。で、ということで私どものこの、家電業界と、の研究に関しましては非常に関係が深い、韓国の学会でありまして、現在、日本と韓国は、家電環境、環境技術含めて引っ張っておりますけれど、非常に中心的に韓国の方でやってらっしゃる学会の会長であります。で引き続きまして、日本の映像情報メディア学会の土井次期会長に、講演をお願いいたします。簡単にご歴史を紹介いたしますと、土井様は東京大学を卒業され、長年東芝で勤務されました。でその現在は、独立行政法人情報通信研究機構のでお勤めされております。それでは土井様よろしくお願いいたします。
ただいまご紹介いただきました土井です。本日はユーザーオリエンテッドイノベーション・トリガードバイ・ソサエティーズと題してお話をさせていただきます。まず最初にですね、私が次期会長を務めます、IEEE、映像メディア学会に関して少しご説明をしたいと思います。この、スライドは IEEE の、ヒストリー遠隔を示しております。一番最初にですね、日本テレビジョン学会として非常に早いんですけれども、1993年に設立されました。その後一度これが解散して、テレビジョン同好会であるとかテレビジョン学会で社団法人テレビジョン学会で、ですね、1996年に社団法人映像情報メディア学会というふうに今の名前に変わりました。で本年ですね、社団法人から一般社団法人に変更になりまして、一社、一っていうのがつきますが、映像情報メディア学会というふうになっております。で、先ほどムーン会長から IEEE のお話がありましたが、IEEE では十分万歩と残念ながら言ってません。いくつか問題があります。一つ目の問題は、日本のどこの学会、多分世界中のどこの学会でも抱えている問題ですが、会員数の減少ということです。今会員は、3400人ぐらい、企業の会員数が200弱ということになっています。で会員が減るということは、それはそのまま、財政問題になるわけです。でこれをどうやって解決していくかというために今映像情報メディア学会では、そのためのタスクフォースを設けて取り組んでおります。で日本の学会、これは、JST のところから持ってきてちょっと解像度が悪いんですけれども、会員が1000名以上の日本の学会が上がっています。今一番数が多いのが、機械学会になります。 その次がですね、先ほど文会長のお話の中にも出てきましたが、IEICE 電子情報通信学会、今3万5千人くらい。で、あと次に多いのがですね、電気学会になります。IEE になります。私、実は、電子情報通信学会は今、総務理事を務めております。電気学会は、昨年度ですね、副会長を務めておりました。で、この関連でもう一つ大きいところが、情報処理学会、IPSJ、まあ、ちょっと2万人かけてますけれども、かつてここの副会長も務めております。そして、今、この映像情報メディア学会の、次期会長ということで、まあ、来年会長になるということで、まあ来年と今年、まあ、2年間で大幅に、会員を増強できるとか、そういう簡単な問題ではないんですが、まあ、今、学会でどういうイノベーションが できるのかというのを少し考えたいと思います。で、まあ、その時に考える時に、まあ、私の専門がヒューマンインターフェースでありますので、コンシューマーエレクトロニクス、まあ、そういう家電製品をデザインしていくという時の、まあ、デザイナーとユーザーの関係というのをちょっと今振り返ってみたいと思います。一番最初のデザインというのは、まあ、デザイナーがデザインしてユーザーに、まあ、提供するということ、まあ、押し付けというと変なんですが、それがフォア2からフォアに変わり、つい最近まではウィズになりました。まあ、一緒にということです。で、今はですね、まあ、ユーザーエクスペリエンスとかいろいろ言われてますけど、バイユーザーということで、アジャイルメソッドとかハッカソンとかいろいろ言われてますが、ユーザーが何を望んでいるのかというのを、ユーザーに聞いてもよくわからないので、ユーザー自身が自分でやりたいことを、設計できるように やるというような、そういう形に変わってきています。なので、ユーザーが参加する、ユーザー自らがデザインしていくというふうに変わってきています。で、これと同じようにイノベーションも変わってきていると思います。ユーザーが自らイノベーションを起こすということです。今までのイノベーションの取り分は、まあ、例えばテクノロジー取り分であったりビジネス取り分であったりしたわけです。あともう一つがユーザーニーズであったわけですが、このユーザーニーズというのがなかなかわからないということで、この全部を合わせて、テクノロジービジネス、ユーザーニーズを全部合わせてデザインを考えましょう。そこに新しいイノベーションが、あるのではないかというふうに一つ変わってきていると思います。で、ちょっとこの表、日本語で申し訳ないんですが、経済産業省の白書から持ってまいりました。イノベーションを起こすのに、この青いところはですね、経営者がイノベーションを起こす人たちだと思っているところ、ところが有識者はですね、経営者がいらない、イノベーションを起こすのにそんなに必要ないと思っているものというふうに、こういうふうに実は両極端に分かれております。で、その一つがですね、経営者が必要だと思っているのは推進力であるとか構想力であるとか挑戦心というふうにが、一方ですね、有識者たちはそうではないと、利他精神、自分のためにではなくみんなのためになるもので自己管理力、まあ、まあこれはそうですね。あと質問力です。ユーザーのニーズがわからない、なのでユーザーを集めて単に、いろいろなアンケートをやってもわからないので、ユーザーが一体何を望んでいるのかっていうのを質問して、ユーザー自身が認識していないユーザーが望んでいることを 見出す力ですね。あともう一つが捨てる力。いろいろな機能がてんこ盛りになるわけではなくて、まあ、それをどうやっていらないものを捨てていくかという力で、私はこの4つのものにもう一つ人を巻き込む力というのを入れたいというふうに思います。で、この4つプラス1で考えるとですね、学会って結構メリットがあるのではないかと。まず一番最初の利他精神、学会ってボランティアですよね。なので学会にいらっしゃる方はもうボランティア精神が大変満ち溢れた方なわけです。なのでこれは丸で で次が自己管理力、まあ、そういう意味では、きちんと自分のことが分かって自分は何を望んで、この学会で活動しようかというふうに思って皆さん参加していただいているので、まあ、そういう意味では学会のメンバーは、自己管理力に優れた方がいらっしゃ入っていらっしゃるというふうに思っています。で質問力、まあ、学会のいろいろなコンファレンスとか、スタディ・トラストグループでも皆さんたくさん質問されるので、まあ、これも問題ないと。好奇心旺盛な方たちが入っているわけですから、問題はここじゃないか、捨てる力。たくさん今までいろんなことをやっていて、レガシーがあって、いろいろな、研究会、スタディインタレストグループがあるわけですが、それが本当に新しいユーザーのニーズに沿う、ユーザーを掘り出すような、そういうスペシャルスタディインタレストグループがあるのか。で、それをやるために今までの、研究会とかそういうのをマージできているのかっていうのは、ちょっとそういう意味ではバツなのかなと。ちょここは私が勝手に判断をしております。で、最後に私が付け加えた人を巻き込む力、うん。これは、そういう意味では学会というのは研究者だけではなく、大学人、アカデミアだけではなく、インダストリーも入っているんですよね。IT のメンバーで見てみますと、エレクトロニクスマニファクチャリング、まあ、製造業の方が 33% です。で、放送業界が 26%。で、ガバメント、政府とか、アカデミア、まあ、政府というか私のように独立行政法人もここに含まれてますけど、22%。あと、まあ、通信とその他ということで、たくさんいろいろな分野の方が入り、産業界、官、学ということで、コラボレーションができる、そういう人たちがもともと入っている、そういう意味で、私は学会というのは、人を巻き込む力をもともと持って、人を巻き込みたい、みんなでやろうと思っている人たちがいるところ。というふうに考えます。なので、学会からユーザーオリエンティブなイノベーションを起こすということが十分可能なのではないかと。そういうふうにもし学会を変えることができれば、学会も非常に魅力のあるものになるのではないかなというふうに思っています。IT の、リサーチグループが今、すみません、全部ちゃんと数えてないんですけども、これだけあります。まあ私の関わるヒューマンインターフェースリサーチのコミュニティもありますし、いろいろなメディアエクスプレッションとかそういうところもあります。でこういうところが、まあ、それぞれのグループだけではなくてお互いに協調して何か連携して新しいことをやっていくっていうのも少し考えてみることも必要なのかなというふうにも考えております。でじゃあ IT って今まで学会としてちょっと何かやってきたのかなと、こう振り返ってみました。事務局に教えていただきました。で調べてみますとですね、 IT 委員はいくつか、まあ、大きなイノベーション化とは言えないかもしれませんけれども、ユーザーオリエンティングがそういうものがあるというふうに思ってます。でそれがですね、一つはですね、テストチャートです。IT では、画像圧縮の標準化にも関わっておりまして、でその標準化したもののテストチャート、あるいは、動画ですね、それからどれくらいの品質でなければいけないかと、そういう標準になるものを出してですね、やってます。これはまさに先ほど申し上げた、この、産学官の連携があってできているものです。あともう一つが最近新しく出したものですが、ウルトラハイデフィニションのテレビジョン 4K ですね。今日 CTEC の会場ではまだ私は見に行ってないんですが、午後行こうと思ってますが、 4K のテレビとかたくさん出ています。その 4K のテレビがきちんと 4K の、ハイデフィニション出していますか、ウルトラハイデフィニション出していますかというのを検証するためのそのベースとなる画像を実は IT が出しています、まあ、小さい学会ではありますが、こういうユーザーオリエンティブな まさに学会の、関わっている会員の企業が必要になるものを、製品を出すこと的に必要になるものを出しているわけです。じゃあ今までこれをやってきた、次は何ができるのかというのを考えるとですね、一つはっていうか、やっぱりオリンピックですよね。2020年にオリンピックがあります。2020年のオリンピックに向けて、これは今 NHK さんから提供いただいた資料ですけれども、やはり今 CTEC に出ている 4K の次ということで 8K になるわけです。その 8K に向けて、どういうふうにロードマップを開発してきたかというロードマップになっています。今年2014年にはパブリックビューイングということで FIFA のワールドカップに向けてこのパブリックビューイングを行いですね、私は残念ながら、見ることができなかったんですけれども、非常に 8K という、公開像で、まるで、その FIFA、ブラジルの会場にいるような臨場感を、味わうことが、この見ていただいた方はできたと思います。で、これが2020年に向けてテストブロードキャストが2016年に予定され、そして2018年、20年の2年前ですね、にラウンジするというロードマップになっています。こういうところに、IT も、小さい学会ではありますが、人を巻き込むということで何か、コンテンツを作るとかいうことができないかで、そういう意味では実際にですね、 8K を実現していくためには、当然ながらプロフェッショナルなエキュープメントも必要になりますし、それを放送するための、メディアも必要になります。で、コンシューマーエレクトロニクスとして製品化していくことも必要になりますし、それを支えるテクノロジーとか、実際にそれで見るアプリケーションであるとかコンテンツであるとかいうところも必要になります。こういったたくさんのいろいろなことが必要になってくるわけですが、それに対して、テクノロジーなどに関しましてはアカデミアが、実際 の, 製品などに関しましてはインダストリーが、で放送とかいろいろやろうとすれば当然いろいろな放送の、許可とかいろいろな、公共的な実験とかも必要になりますので、ガバメントも加わって、これを、オールジャパンで、世界に出していく、それというのが実現していきたいと、そういう中に IT も、いろいろな、先ほどのリサーチグループの皆さんなど加わりながらやっていけたらいいなというふうに思っております。本日はどうもありがとうございました。
ありがとうございました。土井宮子様でございました。続きまして、冒頭でご挨拶を頂戴いたしました。IEEE コンシューマーエレクトロニクスソサエティ会長でいらっしゃいます。ステファン・モツァー様をもう一度ご紹介をさせていただきます。
I've titled my presentation how the IEEE Consumer Electronics Society is adapting to changes in the consumer electronics industry. I think it's been very challenging for us as an American-based society what has happened in the last few years. I want to give you a bit of a background, sort of just an overview of what my talk will roughly be about. What's very important to consumer electronics is the industry. I think it's very much an industry-driven branch of knowledge in society. And often, a lot of the fields of IEEE or electrical engineering have faculties teaching in those areas. And it's very rare to find a faculty in the world these days that is actually dedicated to consumer electronics. They generally talk about communications and info technology, but actually, consumer electronics itself, or school of consumer electronics, I'm not aware of any faculties like that anymore. I know when I was based in Singapore, NTU, National Nanyang Technological University, attempted to have a consumer electronics school, but I think gradually when the industry left Singapore, they sort of abolished that as well. And what's really dominant in the industry is the rapid pace and change in technology. I think most of us would be familiar with technology S-curves, and what we're sort of experiencing and seeing is that the time frame, the time interval for an S-curve is getting narrower and narrower. And this has implications for our industry. The longest time interval for an S-curve that I'm aware of belongs to the incandescent light bulb, and that's well over 100 years. It was the technology started in the 1800s, and it's only in recent years that by government laws in a lot of developed countries it's being phased out, but I believe in some developing countries they're still using incandescent light bulbs. And that relates to our industry now that it's becoming more electronic driven. And by the way, congratulations to Japan on receiving the Nobel Prize in Physics for our LED, the blue LED. And that's one of our areas of consumer electronics, really, if you look at it. So actually, consumer electronics is so broad that we win Nobel Prizes in Physics. But the key point here is the time intervals of these technology S-curves, they overlap, and then the time that we need to innovate is getting narrower and narrower. This has an effect on us as a society and us as an industry. Because we're industrial based, another issue that affects us very much is the market windows. Because the S-curves are reducing in time intervals, the market windows, W, is getting narrower and narrower. The area under the curve is the area where you can actually produce a product and make money. And if you have an early entry, you can make a lot of money because the area under the curve is large. If you're lagging in technology trying to copy, what happens is you're a late entry and the area under the curve becomes smaller and smaller. And if you want to look at it in more detail, you find it's a break-even point or a point beyond which you're not going to make profits. And some parts of our industry are down to 6-month cycles. I think Tom here is from the storage industry. I've been affiliated with the storage industry for many years as well, and the storage industry probably for 20 years ago now has been working on 6-month cycles. They're probably lower than 6 months right now. And that's amazing how innovation is driving these developments and how we can survive in an industry where a product development takes 18 months but it only has 6 months market cycle. Before I continue and relate back to these changes in the industry, I want to give a brief overview of the IEEE. IEEE is the world's largest professional society. We have over 430,000 members, 45 technical societies, of which the Consumer Electronics Society is one. We are actually one of the oldest societies in the IEEE, but we're not the biggest. We're probably the most all-encompassing society. Yet, in many parts of the world, I was surprised as I was traveling around the world as president, people are not aware that there is such a thing as a consumer electronics society. Our presence, you see 160 countries and all our journals. I think probably the best thing that we're known for is our publications. We have top-ranked, we probably have the leading publications in various industry segments in the world. This is geographic distribution. IEEE is a global association, and we've divided the world into 10 regions. And what we see in this part of the world here, Asia Pacific, is the largest region. When I say the largest, it's 112,000 members compared to region 1 to 6. Well, the US has got 6 regions, so each region is smaller than what we have here in Asia. The other thing too is the growth of outside of regions 1 to 6. If you add up all the numbers, it's slightly more than what we have in regions 1 to 6. So what used to be a US-centric society now is changing to a global society. And for us, the consumer electronics industry it has had probably a bigger effect than for other societies in the IEEE, because globally East Asia has been the dominant player, has sort of gradually taken over, and most of what's happening in the industry is now happening in East Asia, not so much in the US. Probably the most popular consumer electronics company is Apple. They have a lot of hype and they're well known. They're very profitable, very innovative. But the trend generally is to go to East Asia. A lot of the Western companies, if you look at television particularly, that used to sort of be the core business of our society, it's sort of not the major strength anymore. Plus, Western countries really don't dominate television anymore. The US has given up and just handed over to Asia. Europe is struggling. There's only a few small companies trying to survive in Germany. And apart from that, I think there's nothing else in the Western television industry. But television doesn't define consumer electronics anymore. IEEE, to be able to cope with such a large geographic dispersion, is grouped into two sort of major strands. One is called members' geographic activities, because we realize that different parts of the world have different needs. So we have organizational units, as we call them, which we call chapters and sections, which look after the needs in the local area. They understand the local customs, the local situation much better than somebody in the US would. So that's why we broke that up. But even in the US, there's diversity. Then we have technical activities, which looks after, which the societies actually belong to, and societies work with the geographic units, which is local chapters, local sections, which we have here in Japan. We have two chapters here, and our Japan chapters actually organize this conference. To make it relevant for people to join our society, what we're actually trying to do is look at how we structure membership and what the needs of our members are. So we talk about a membership life cycle. And we want to engage with our members right at the beginning when they're in university, studying and getting ready to become professional engineers. So we involve them with the student time. Then when they graduate, they become young professionals from our terminology. So we try to engage with them when they're trying to build their career and plan their career. And our society has identified that as well. And what you've seen, if you've attended our conference, you notice that we're running workshops here in Japan on English skills. We realize that some of the people here in this part of the world have more problems with expressing themselves in a foreign language. So we're providing some help. Last year we did some management stuff. And a theme that we're having throughout our conferences and events around the world is helping young professionals, and that also includes women in engineering as well, to develop their soft skills. Universities provide them with education and skills to develop a professional career. What we don't provide in the universities is with the skills to plan their career. You just don't have a successful career by leaving university hoping for the best. If you can take control of your career and plan it, then you have a more chance of succeeding. We had an interesting presentation this morning before this year about women in engineering and how they sort of try to work with their careers, and we can see how they are represented it. So we're trying to help out and provide opportunities for that. We look at the needs of our members and also of life members. Just because you retired, you know, if you've been spending most of your career, 30 or 40 years in engineering, you don't switch off and sort of say overnight, I'm no longer an engineer. You still have to somehow stay in touch with that. We also recognize the achievement of our members. IEEE being a global society, the size that we are, and look at a lot of the dominant publications that we have some of the people which were really big innovators and which really changed the world with some of the work. Just Dr. Doi, who spoke before me, Edison has just under 300 patents. For her bio, I saw she has over 300 patents. So Dr. Doi actually has more patents than Edison. You know, so that's some of the type of people that are coming and joining us in the IEEE. And of course, we need to recognize that. So we have a number of awards. Also, we recognize achievements of professional career with different grades of membership, like senior member, fellow, and people who serve for a long time can become life members in the different categories of our society. The key point to our society, I think the reason why IEEE or any professional society is important is information. If it weren't for information that we can disseminate, that we can take to and work with, we probably wouldn't have societies. And one of the things that information means is also being able to publish. If you're an academic career, you need an avenue to show your work, and the way you show your achievements is by being first to publish, or at least publishing major landmark papers. These are the publications that are associated with the Consumer Electronics Society. The top one, the Transactions, is our oldest and probably most prestige publication at this point in time. And the latest and the newest edition is the Consumer Electronics Magazine. That's this one here. Over the years, I've been talking to members and solicited to them, you know, particularly people who dropped out. We've asked them, why are you discontinuing your membership with the CE Society? And one of the comments that was made to us was, well, you have nothing to offer. You have one annual conference years ago, so it's nothing that long ago. Beginning of this new century, our society had two conferences. One of them doesn't belong to the society, it belongs to the MGA, started in Asia, not the US, and that's a roaming conference. And what the society really had was only one conference, the ICC in Las Vegas, our flagship conference, and one Transactions. The Transactions are very prestige, but what our members said to us, if they're not academia, they're boring, they're dry and difficult to read. So if you're not an expert in a certain field, it's a challenge to read some of the stuff. And it's not really there sort of to update you quickly. So after surveying that, I came up with the idea that we should start a magazine, and that's this year, Consumer Electronics Magazine. Consumer Electronics Magazine has been a big success for our society. In 2013, we won the Apex Award against, I think, 2,500 other magazines. And that was quite an achievement for us, particularly since no other IEEE magazine won the award, came first place. I have a few copies here, so anybody would like to have a copy who's not down at the conference, just come up and just grab a copy. To help disseminate information, we also have a distinguished lecture program. So we sort of try to have people move around the world, have distinguished people. When they're traveling, we sort of appoint them and say, okay, go out and sort of give a time, give a talk, a presentation. And they're quite well received because we have some very high quality talks. Tom was sitting in the audience there. He spent a lot of time talking about storage and consumer electronics all over the world. We have other people as well, some very famous people. Before you saw a slide of Bob Frankston, if you're not aware who he is, he invented the electronic spreadsheet, and he's also very, a lot of innovation and automation as well. So we have people like that, or Brandenburg, who's the father of MP3, or Keith, father of CD's technology. Now to our conferences that we do, we have the flagship conference in Las Vegas, and now when you talk about these magazines, these publications, and these conferences, if you look at what I showed you before, the narrow market cycles, the reducing time to market, the obsolescence of technology, our contribution starts through conferences, help, makes you more aware. When you're like at CTEC, you go out to the floor and you can sort of see the technology that's in the market today. What you don't see at CTEC or the CES in Las Vegas is, what's going to happen tomorrow? If you come into our conference, you can get an idea of what's happening. Researchers come to conferences to claim to be first with innovations, but also to measure, engage themselves, to benchmark themselves against the competition, so they can see where they stand against what the competition is doing. It's a good sort of peer review method. Las Vegas conference has been around for more than 30 years. We don't know exactly how old it is, because it's sort of, like there's a famous commercial that says, it's lost in time. We've been calling it ICC for about 30 years. We think it's probably around the 50-year mark, but we didn't keep records in the old days of the conference, so we really don't know. But to help our members and to be more relevant to people, disseminate information more readily, having a conference once a year in Las Vegas does not serve our membership. So what we've done is we've duplicated the model, and we're presenting conferences like GCCE's output of that here in Japan, and it's been very, very well received. Similar, we went to the IFA a year before GCCE, and IFA's in Berlin, which used to be the largest consumer electronic show, and they opened us with open arms, and so I said, come to us. And coincidentally, when IFA celebrated 50th anniversary, that's the first year that we had our conference there. So we have a flagship conference in Europe that's been growing, it's making major milestones. And again, we're providing information to enable us to cope with these fast changes in industry. On top of that, we have ICCE in China, Taiwan, 2016, Korea. We have a few more to come. We're negotiating. Actually, the work that we've been doing building up these conferences has raised a lot of attention by the Chinese government. The Chinese government actually knocked on our door when I became president the first year. Some representatives from the Chinese government came to Las Vegas and looked me up, but they didn't send me any emails or anything. They just turned up at the conference and sort of said, hey, we want a conference in Shanghai. And said, okay, let's start working on it. And they said, it's not as easy. We don't just open a conference the next day. We've got to build up the network. So we've had a strategy of working with China and developing our network. So we started in Shenzhen. We will start off next year in Shanghai, and after that we'll be going to Beijing. My guess is that the first time we'll exceed 1,000 paper conference will be in China. Although I think Tokyo has also, the Japan conference also has the potential. But Korea also has done very well. Korea's ICE was the second largest ever held ICE. The largest was here in Japan with Professor Hase in 2009. So Southeast Asia is really the place where we can bring a lot of synergy together. And it actually makes sense if you look back to the first graphs I've shown you about the S technology curve and all that. Asia's really adopted that. And this is something that probably the people in America haven't woke up, or members in America haven't woken up to. The CE Society, more so than any other IEEE society, is Asian-focused. The major developments and innovations in this industry happening in East Asia, Japan, and especially Korea are the two dominant countries right now for this industry. China is on the rise, will come up and be very dominant as well. So in the next 20 or 30 years, as long as I'm going to be around, I think Asia is going to be where the action is happening. We need to address it. If you look at where all our conferences are building up, they're not building up in the US, they're building up here in East Asia. To cope and adapt with all this here, IEEE started an initiative called Future Directions, and the reason why I was mentioning Thomas, he was looking at me. more importantly, I think, is that Tom was one of the people who involved the initiative there, and when he told me about it, I said, Tom, what you've got to do is, we need one in our society, because with the changes that are happening in our society, we need to look at the future. That's what Future Directions is about. We're trying to predict what technologies are going to come in. I used to be an engineer with Philips, and I was working in Philips. We were never worried about Sony or Panasonic or Toshiba, because we knew what they were doing. We could sort of follow and trace that. What we were worried about was something like Apple. Apple wasn't a consumer electronics company in those days, but we're sure other companies will come up, and it's only a matter of time before new companies start up out of the blue, small companies you don't think of immediately. And the next thing you know, there are major competitors that have disruptive technologies which will come in changed the way we worked. And if you look at our industry, it has changed. It's no longer radio and TV. Look at our future directions, what we're looking at there. I've got a point there, white paper on mobile power, which will be recent, I think, end of the year, early next year. And the other thing that's happened to us with our conference in Berlin, we've picked up that healthcare has become a major issue. And it's interesting that in Europe, a lot of the companies, when they moved out of television and radio, the area they're moving into, where they're innovating, is healthcare, because the advances in the actual technology, the components that we have available, and the materials to produce new products, enable us to move into the healthcare and to come up with low costs. Prices is a big issue, and if you look at what our industry has done, it has innovated to the extent where cost down is a major issue. Every 6 months, prices don't go up, prices go down, and industries need to adapt to that. So what our society is really trying to do with future directions, with the conference we have, also with cooperating with other societies, like the IEIE, the societies here in Japan, the fact that we're here in Japan, is trying to look for new opportunities to move forward. You know, we're trying to open doors for collaboration to make our industry relevant, and also to get people who join us to be able to provide a path and a way and an avenue for them to work with us, to that we can be relevant to them and help them find these new opportunities.